next time won't be until 2025. Meanwhile, today, May 7th, birthday of this guy, David Hume, who is mentioned in the bulletin, and we'll mention him again a little bit later on. It's just completely fortuitous. It's just weird how no God arranges these things. That's it's his birthday today. We're going to be talking about some of his ideas. Also born on May 7th, these two guys, Johannes Brahms in 1833 and Pyotr Ilyich Tchaikovsky in 1840. May 7th is the anniversary of the founding of the city of New Orleans in 1718. It's also the day that the Lusitania was sunk by a German U-boat in 1915, which of course brought the U.S. into World War I. It is the day that documents declaring the unconditional surrender of all German forces were signed that ended World War II. Now these were accepted on the 7th, and then VE Day, Victory in Europe Day, was celebrated the next day, May 8th, and that's when this like this famous picture and so forth, were taken. So now the question is, who signed those surrender papers, right? Hitler had already killed himself. Goebbels had killed himself, whom Hitler had designated as the next chancellor. Meanwhile, Hitler had already fired Goering and Himmler for trying to undermine him and surrender sooner than he was ready. Well, it was the Nazi Grand Admiral Alfred Jodl who signed the surrender documents, authorized by this guy, Kurt Dönitz. That was the guy that Hitler had designated as the successor president of Germany. Who's ever heard of this guy, Karl Dönitz? Oh, some people do. Merlin, you haven't? You lived through all this stuff. So, anyways, it turns out, you know, the Nazis just documented everything and everything. You know, took a lot of films and things, and it turns out that there's documentation of how that all happened. So we'll just bring you up to speed here.
Karl Dönitz ran the Atlantic U-boat campaign.
Yeah.
Lots of that on the History Channel.
Yeah.
All right.
So.
Red tape, really.
You see, I thought I was going to be a proper... Yes, that was our fault. We didn't mean to give you that impression. All right, I'll make the call. You wouldn't mind just doing me a quick Heil der Nitz, would you? Just so I can say I've had one.
I don't think that would
be... Please. Thanks, guys.
So that's your history lesson. That's how it really happened. Except you were there.
Their English is amazing.
Well, it's in translation. Universal translator departed from Captain Kirk. So, one more thing, too. May 7th. This day in 2000, Vladimir Putin was inaugurated as the president of Russia, and he's still there. Doesn't appear to be leaving anytime soon. So about 3 weeks ago, NBC5 called the Texas Church of Freethought to ask for someone to come on air for a series that they were doing on religious activities in the area. Get the right one here, and. I asked around to see who might have availability, and a couple of you know that. I don't like to just do all this stuff myself, but it was the middle of the day on a Friday, so I agreed to go on. Hopefully the connection's going to work here. It did click. Oh, there it goes. Might be more than what the hotel's allowing us to stream. We couldn't get on YouTube either.
How much time did they give you to prepare this?
They didn't give me any time to prepare it. I asked what kind of questions they were going to ask, and they did say that they would ask, you know, what our church does and what charitable activities we do, explain a little bit. So the host came on and basically introduced and said, oh, they don't even call themselves a church, they're just a community, and there's no Bibles or songs of worship. And then, you know, then they said, North Texas Church, print. Were you able to get it?
Yeah, I'm
there. Oh, okay.
Sorry, guys.
That's fine. This is for a different video. Chair, a videographer, solving problems for us. So anyway, they started out saying that I should explain what we're doing and actually how many of us are actually atheists as compared to who's not sure about God. You know, they tried to focus on that, so I just immediately deflected that and indicated that, which isn't exactly true, that we don't always talk about, we don't come in here, well, there's no God and we have a ceremony about that. It's sort of not even relevant. It's no more relevant to us than, say, reincarnation is relevant to Christianity, and I pointed that out. So then they just moved on, and we talked about blood drives that we've done in the past, and then they wrapped it up. It was a very, very brief segment. And then as I'm actually leaving the place, I get a call from some lady in Fort Worth who says, I just saw you on TV, and I'm interested in your church, and so forth. I don't think she came today. She's a flight attendant for American Airlines. So anyways, it's good to get the word out, and even if people don't come, they know we're here, and that's an important thing. Anyways, you can go to the NBC5 website and look that up. The link is actually on our Facebook page, and it was sent out as a Twitter notice as well. But I thought it was very interesting. It came off pretty well, especially since NBC5 is the same channel that some years ago just excoriated us. They were having a series on different religious groups in the area. They did one on a child preacher and so forth, and it's all this fluffy, wonderful, we love it type of thing. But then when they did us, they only gave us about half the time, and the rest of the time they went and interviewed Baptist people at the seminary who said that we're all going to hell. So that was not very, very nice of them. So, back to the show. dictionaries defined free thought, and you can look up most, a lot of dictionaries do have this as opinions about, especially about matters of religion without regard to tradition, authority, and established belief. So it kind of defines us negatively, but what remains? Facts and reason remain. Factualism is a word, it turns out, and that's another option. People ask what you are, you say, I'm a factualist. Like Joe Friday, just the facts, man.
Unless you're an alternative factualist.
Unless you're an alternative factualist, that's true. Well, there's also the Church of the Reformed factualism and all of that. So. And then there's also rationalism and rationalist. Those are great words, but they might carry a certain connotation of rigidity. But that's appropriate because reason has rules. And to think about whatever you want is not the same as to think however you want. It's not, you can't just make up your own thinking. There are rules of thinking, and you have to have regard for those principles of reason. There's a word for errors in thinking, errors in reasoning. We call them fallacies. And you can find a long list of fallacies online. Very interesting stuff, actually, and worth the perusing. We could probably even do a little church series looking at one fallacy at a time. Would probably take us several decades. These fallacies show up every day. You can find them in the newspapers, and we ourselves stumble into them as well, usually through simple carelessness. I'm certainly not immune to that myself. But through effort and by forming good habits, we can, each one of us, me, you, anyone, everyone, we can do better. And we should not focus so much, as is the cultural norm, on the idea of reaching conclusions and having beliefs that would then come to define us as whatever our favorite ism is, our ideological commitments. That's not what it is or should be about. We should always be willing to rethink things, to go over the grounds of our beliefs. There's a phrase at the end of Voltaire's Candide, Voltaire, the famous French freethinker, who put it metaphorically what we should be doing, and that is to cultivate our gardens. Of course, we don't need to doubt such things as that there's a world outside our heads. I don't get up every morning and say, well, is medical science true? Let me think this through. We don't need to worry about gravity or electromagnetism or a cause and effect suddenly cutting out. More about miracles in a bit, but we should be willing to reconsider our opinions, especially in our everyday lives, our opinions of other people and their motives about what is important in life, about what our goals should be, about how we should go about pursuing happiness, and even about what happiness is or should be. Most of all, it, this business of religion, what the theologian Paul Tillich and the Supreme Court after him called matters of ultimate meaning. It's about being open to, even certain of, the possibility that we are under some misapprehensions as we go through life, that we have made mistakes. Mistakes that we are as yet unaware of, but that we are ignorant of these things, and that if, were we to discover them, we could, that those discovery of those things could and would enrich our lives and improve our situation. So, lots of things online about critical thinking. The trick, of course, is applying that in your everyday personal life with your boss and coworkers and family and all of that. So here's our creed. We're ready to rethink it anytime and rewrite it or re-say it anytime. We invite your thoughts and ideas about that. You can email us through the website. So please check out our website at churchoffreethought.org, and there's now several dozens of sermon lecture items there in bulletins going back to 2008. There's a forum under the services section, not very active, but go there and post your ideas, your jokes, anything that you would like to share. Like our Facebook page and sign up for our Twitter feed. Aaron is our social media czar. And the addresses for how to do that are on page 2 of the bulletin. And take extra copies of the bulletin, by the way, because you can spread them around, leave them in places, and there's plenty of extras. So remember Don Newland, Don Terranova, as we call him, since he's trying to be somewhat anonymous while he's coming out as a atheist, having been a Christian missionary to Vietnam. As many of you know, he's back in Asia. He's working there as an English teacher. He sent this picture to me yesterday. Did he make that up? He's looking really thin, too. I had to email him back and say, is it the insects in your diet, or what is it? He said it's smaller portion sizes and that he's not eating pizzas and hamburgers anymore. So he sends his greetings and well wishes to all of us. next month's service, 4 weeks from now, June 4th. It's going to be on something called the Argument from Reason. How many have heard of that? The Argument from Reason. You've heard of it. Okay. I predict this is going to become a thing because the creationists have lost, pretty much. They're going to continue to percolate out there just like flat earthers do. But this is another line of attack against naturalism and a naturalistic worldview that we free thinkers hold. The basic boiled down idea is that if everything that goes on in our brains, and in fact the only thing that goes on in our brains are molecules in motion, just things going on, material stuff, doing what it cannot help doing, just like it, things cannot help doing what they do in a test tube, then we really cannot know anything because it's impossible for us to reason our way to any conclusions using these unreasonable things of which our brains are made. In other words, a naturalistic view of reality is self-refuting. You got to think about that. We're going to spend the whole service, a good part of it, talking about that. So this relates to last month's service, too, on why be reasonable, and, of course, to this month's service on miracles, because the best-known proponent of this argument from reason was C.S. Lewis, probably the greatest Christian apologist of the 20th century, who brought it up in his book on miracles. And this is a quote from jumped ahead here. I guess I didn't have a slide for this. Don't look at that. Unsee it. I have it down here. He says, I'm asked to believe that reason is simply the unforeseen and unintended byproduct of mindless matter at one stage of its endless and aimless becoming. Here is flat contradiction. They ask me at the same moment to accept a conclusion and to discredit the only testimony on which that conclusion can be based. So we'll think about that, because it's not that difficult a problem, but you have to understand it to begin with. So you really need to be here next month on June 4th for that, for the argument for reason. So you're primed. And I've been prescient before in 10, 20 years, this is going to become a big deal, a big line of attack against us. Kim Robertson, who's here, and I was going to say you're with the kids, but she's taking on the babysitting, which is not at all, not that. But our young free thinkers need food for thought, too. Don't you like to read? What are you reading now? Anything interesting? About what? Star Wars book. Well, there's stuff in there, definitely. Most of us, of course, struggled through years and years of trying to make sense of all the crazy superstition and nonsense in the world. So we need volunteers when we have children young enough who want to goof off with each other, basically, to take on this responsibility, really a privilege of guiding our less experienced freethinkers along this road to discovery. I think if you talk to any youngsters, they'll tell you about what their experiences in school, and my kids certainly did when they were school age, and how do you navigate that. And one of the things I tried to impart, in fact, my oldest daughter, I had dinner with her a couple weeks ago, and she repeated it back to me, and I said, aha, where did you ever hear that from? And she realized it was from me, and that is some famous Englishman once said, be smarter than other people if you can, but don't tell them. Of course, we never know how many kids and what ages of children will be showing up, so you might even have nothing to do like kid can join us today. So, who's going to do it during the June service? Are you going to, since you're off today, do it in June? Okay. All right, good. Book club is in abeyance, and the leader of that group, Nero, had to give it up, so there's an opportunity for anyone interested who wants to have their own little empire of NTCOF book club. Whoever takes it on has wide latitude to do it the way they want. Think of it as a study of our sacred scripture, which is all the writings of those who've had anything of importance and value to say, interesting and meaningful things. So come talk to me if you have interest in that. And of course, we promote it on our Facebook and the emails and so forth. So we have a moment of science called the Miraculous Weeping Statues, and the kid prepared this material from us. Our moment of science is a recurring feature. We don't have it every single service, but as much as is appropriate. But lessons from science about the meaning of everyday life. We don't worship science, but the methods and approaches and the tools of science are applicable everywhere, even if they can't always be checked by other scientists. And that's, of course, the thing with religion. It's a personal thing, so only you maybe can know what you're doing, but you still can know that. All right, so not just weeping statues, but statues that weep, drink, bleed, sweat, and the key concept here is capillary action. So on September 21st, 1995, this Hindu worshiper in New Delhi, uh, in, ship by holding a spoonful of milk up to it. The milk disappeared from the spoon, leading the worshiper to believe that the statue was drinking it. The phenomenon was replicated in Hindu temples around the world and was touted as a miracle by these Hindu religious figures. It was soon discovered that statues of other gods and goddesses were thirsty too. People flocked to temples, milk sales surged, and interpretations and prophecies are made by religious followers. However, the Hindu milk miracle is not unique. Religious statues and icons have been doing this for years. In the 1970s, a deaf Catholic nun in Akita, Japan, reported receiving messages through a wooden statue of the Virgin Mary. For years, the statue reportedly wept, perspired fragrantly, and bled through stigmata on her palms. Japanese public television broadcast video of the statue weeping in December of 1973. The deaf nun reported stigmatic experiences of meeting a guardian angel who comforted her, and after a decade, her hearing was restored. Another visitor claimed the statue healed her brain tumor after she prayed for it. In 2012, Catholics flocked to Mumbai, India to see a statue of Jesus weeping and to drink the tears of Jesus in the hope of curing ailments. Sanal Edamaruku investigated and found that the dripping was caused by capillary action, fluid being drawn up from underneath the statue from sewage water, which fed this stuff into the base of the statue and came out as tears, and people were getting this and eating it. And yeah, so we're going to have a video. That's the one we couldn't get off of YouTube here, but you can go look up this guy's name, Sanal, S-A-N-A-L, Edamaruku. I think the title of the, we found it on YouTube, but we couldn't stream it from this location. It's like, Man Leaves India After Debunking Statue.
Well, yeah, he had a lot of backlash over it. He had death threats and everything for
you heard about this, yeah, yeah, that's right. The guy fled to Finland. The Archbishop of Mumbai offered to have the charges dropped if he could only just apologize, and he politely declined. To evade arrest, he moved to Finland, where he's been working to get the Indian blasphemy laws repealed. But due to the murder of another freethinker in India for promoting rational thought, this guy who's in Finland now does not feel he can safely return to India, even if the charges against him are dropped. So that was going to be the video. So there are many natural forces that move water. It's a big feature on our planet. But capillary action refers to the movement of water, often against gravity, through porous materials and on some non-porous surfaces. Water molecules exhibit adhesion and cohesion due to their electrostatic properties. Cohesion refers to how the water molecules are attracted to each other, and adhesion, their interaction with other materials. Now, as we know, each molecule of water is made of one oxygen atom and two hydrogen atoms bonded together. And of course, chemical bonds are sharing, trading and sharing electrons. But when they share electrons, as in the case of the water molecule, it's an uneven type of sharing. The oxygen atom holds the electrons more tightly, making that part of the molecule more negatively charged. So as we say, water is a polar. It has positive and negative parts. So the water molecules are attracted to each other because of this charge difference, and to other materials that also have that type of property. So we see this cohesion between water molecules and the tendency of water to form droplets, and the surface tension between water. And for example, when you fill a container, it gets to the top, and the water will actually bulge over a while before it goes down the edge. And of course, if you look at it in a tube, you get that meniscus, which is the water crawling up the sides. It wants to interact with the glass, which also has positive minus charges in it. Water molecules are also attracted to other molecules that have those uneven charge distribution. So that's why you have water droplets that cling to other surfaces. So, you know, especially biological materials, we've all experienced the sensation of sweating. The water molecules are acted on by these forces of adhesion, cohesion, and the gravity. And although we think of gravity as being a very strong force, it's what keeps us on the earth, gravity is actually pretty weak compared to electrostatic forces. And you can demonstrate this by making a thin stream of water come out your faucet, brush your hair, and hold the brush up, and you see it'll bend the water stream. I used to do that to my kids. It would freak them out. They didn't realize that. The forces of adhesion and cohesion jointly create what's called capillary action, which draws water upwards into narrow spaces. when the surface of the space is charged enough that the adhesive forces are stronger than the cohesive forces, the water molecules actually rise up into the space, where the, and then those cohesive forces draw the other water molecules in after it. Here are some examples of capillary reaction, paper absorbing a puddle, plants. That's how trees get water up in, you know, when you look at a redwood, how does the water get up there? The tree doesn't have any pumps, it doesn't have a heart. How does the water get up to the top of the tree? By capillary reaction, pretty amazing. After observing the Hindu milk miracle, scientists from India's Ministry of Science and Technology added food coloring to the milk and observed that some of the milk ended up at the base of the statue, so it's going up and then down because of gravity. You can actually siphon things that way. But the Hindu milk miracle has only lasted a couple of days at a time. The scientists feel like there are some other factors that they don't completely understand, but that just helps the believers all the more attribute it to a supernatural event. And conversely, once capillary reaction has drawn water into masonry, so you might have seen that type of thing in basements. We don't have any basements around here, but up north we certainly saw that. Once it's drawn up, then if there's cracks or pinholes in the glazing, like on these statues, then it comes up. And of course, you know, some of these crying statues have been found to be the clergy going in and putting stuff on it. And the Catholic Church doesn't have too much to say about that because, oh, well, it draws believers and creates interest. So that's their way of advertising. And believe it or not, there's lots of other weird miracles in the Catholic Church. A couple of cases that, at least, that were supposedly the bread was divinely turned into human flesh. It was analyzed and found to be human flesh. So, but of course, it couldn't have been anybody switched it or something like that. So that has been your moment of science, miraculous statues. All right, so our main topic of miracles. Years ago, the NTCUF had a member who subsequently, she was a nice lady, but she subsequently moved away and then we didn't hear from her. And then recently, this past March, she just posted on our Facebook page the following, and edited this for brevity. I was a member of NTCUF. I left and remained unchurched for many years. 14 years ago, I felt a very strong urge to go back to my Episcopal faith. 1 year and 11 months later, to the day, I don't know what's amazing about 1 year and 11 months, but anyways, my precious son, Sean, died suddenly at the age of 34 years. I believe I was led back to the church to help me deal with this unbearable loss. Both my husband and I have had many signs that Sean is in some way still with us. The most recent is strange actions with my earrings. Sean has been pulling an earring out of my ear and tossing it on the floor. Early after Sean's death, I was talking to a priest in her office when suddenly a metal pocket angel flipped itself out of a bowl. Both of us were somewhat stunned. When I got up to leave, the priest handed it to me and said, "I believe this is for you." I took it and said, "So you saw what I saw?" She responded with, "Yes, I did." And she concludes by saying, "I defy you to explain these and other episodes." There's a lot to unpack there.
Margin of personal experience.
Including logical fallacies. But the real reason or reasons she went back to her Episcopal faith, that's another issue. Obviously, the death of her son, she doesn't mention the circumstances. They would be devastating under any imaginable circumstances. Her way of dealing with this terrible and crushing loss, which she calls unbearable. Her earrings and other signs, I mean, think about whether that's healthy, how she's dealing with them. Her earrings and these signs that allow her to deny that her son is really gone and to focus on what he was when he was alive. But did you ever have something fall down or get knocked over? Because without realizing it or being aware of it, you bumped into it or nudged something else that dislodged it. I remember once doing microsurgery with another physician, and you're looking under the microscope, and every little while there's a little jiggle. You're like, what's going on there? It must have been something supernatural, right? No, the other doctor's pregnant, and fetal movement was actually just she was leaning up, and you know that was causing a little bit of motion under the microscopic. When you're looking under the microscope. So, anyways, I think we've all turned around and something fell down. How did that happen? Well, you know, some article in your clothing or something knocked into something else that knocked into something else. So, way too many things here to have a go at in such a short time. But consider this, that unlikely things happen all the time. Even things that seem so unlikely as to seem mind-boggling. And partly this is because so many things are always happening. How many of us have had something really weird happen? we all got stories, you know, about just something really weird. Yeah, I do too. In fact, I feel guilty because once that we involved making airline reservations and the person at the other end of the line kind of took advantage of the situation a lot or believed that I was psychic and had psychic powers. That probably wasn't so good. Not very nice. So, but we notice and remember that such things, especially more than events that seem to follow the regular course of everyday affairs, these kind of things that happen to us stand out, particularly when we look for them and when we're predisposed to notice them. Consider that among 23 randomly selected people, there's a greater than 50% chance that two of them will have the same month, day, birthday. Are there 23 of us here today, or pretty near that number? We'd have to go through and see, but only 23 people before there's, it's more likely than not that two of them will have the same month and day of birthday. Here's a weird thing I didn't know. The Bulgarian lottery chose the winning numbers of 4, 15, 23, 24, 35, and 42 on September 6th of 2009. 4 days later, the exact same numbers came up again. Had to be an error. And the North Carolina Cash 5 lottery, I imagine there were five numbers, I didn't have time to look into the details here. They produced the same winning numbers 2 days apart, on July 9th and 11th in 2007.
But I'm sure not in the same order.
That's possible. Simple math, well, not so simple it turns out. Math turns out to be very complicated to work this problem out. How many times do you have to flip a coin for it to be more likely than not that so many heads or tails will show up in a row? Well, it turns out you only have to flip a coin 22 times for it to be more likely than not, greater than a 50% chance, that four heads in a row will come up. And in 1986, a Cambridge mathematician, John Littlewood, sat down and figured he was going to calculate this out. He calculated that an ordinary person, he just made estimates as to the kinds of things that happened to you that you would notice. You can expect to personally see or hear a one in a million exceptional event of special significance, as he called it, about once a month. It's called Littlewood's Law. And if Littlewood's Law is correct, then worldwide many billions of exceptional events of special significance happen every year. And this is not even counting all the perceptions, all the misperceptions and misapprehensions that people have. But now suppose that something happens for which no one, not even all the best scientists and clever people in the world, can think of a good explanation. Let's say something that literally violates the known and familiar and not always completely understood laws or regularities of the natural world. You know, there's no capillary action going on. A pocket angel levitates out of a bowl. What are we to think of that? Well, to begin with, such an event would cast all of scientific understanding in doubt. If that really happened, you'd have to doubt everything that the scientists have ever observed and recorded. After all, if the regularities of events that we observe in the natural world cannot be relied upon, then no experimental data and none of the technologies generated by scientific knowledge could be relied on. You couldn't drive your car and not be assured that it wasn't just going to cut out or float up in the air. Any number of things can happen. Just list them all out, all the things you could think of. It wouldn't just be that things like cars and passenger aircraft and computers and medical devices, some of which have been implanted into people's bodies. It wouldn't just be that they would have parts that would fail or wear out or something. No, it would be that the principles on which these things operate could change unpredictably with no way of knowing how or when. And when you read literature about miracles, a lot of times the proponents are saying, well, you know, it's just really tough to bring a miracle in a lab, but considering all the experiments that are done in labs all the time, I mean, scientists are people too. Why wouldn't something levitate and move across the room while they're doing an experiment on you name it? So we would truly be living in the times of our distant ancestors if this is the way the world was, the people who had not yet recognized any but the most rudimentary regularities of the natural world. Imagine what it must have been like to live in those conditions where everyone knows that most things that happen are controlled by supernatural forces. It was, as Carl Sagan put it, a demon-haunted world. At one time, there were probably not even words to express the ideas that we now take for granted about the natural world and its laws, because nobody could think that way. As far as we can tell, the first person who tried to think our way was the first Greek philosopher, Thales of Miletus, who lived in the 6th century BCE, which is on the coast of Turkey down here. This is not actually a... It's a bust of him, they put his name on it, but it's kind of like the statue of John Harvard at the Harvard campus. Nobody knows what they look like. They just had somebody pose and they made it up. But we just like to have these images to deal with. So he lived in the 6th century BCE. Like Aristotle, centuries later, he was interested in all kinds of different things. There are many stories about him, including probably the first absent-minded professor story, where supposedly he was walking along, looking at the stars and fell into the ditch, and somebody was nearby and said, you would just look where you were going, that wouldn't have happened. But the ideas that Thales proposed to make sense of were notably the big things, that they were free of the supernatural. This is one thing that I never learned when I took philosophy classes years ago in school. They said, oh, this philosopher says everything is this way, another philosopher says everything is that way. But the thing they all had in common, what they were trying to do, is come up with explanations that did not involve Zeus and Poseidon and things like that. No writings of Thales survive, but we know of his ideas through Aristotle, who relates that Thales said that everything is full of gods. And that sounds supernatural, but again, think about the concepts and even the vocabulary that they had at the time, because clearly what he meant was that we can understand what is going on in the world by looking at the things themselves. Not the other things, not at Poseidon and some spirit, whatever, at the things themselves, at their specific intrinsic character, nature, or the soul of things, which themselves determine how they behave. And that was a revolutionary idea. It was the materialistic germ of science. Once planted in the human mind, the world could not look the same. But the idea that there is a supernatural world as well as a natural world persists. And as I mentioned earlier, the greatest Christian apologist of the 20th century, C.S. Lewis, he's the guy that wrote the Chronicles of Narnia, that kind of stuff, and a lot of other imaginative works, as well as a lot of stuff, Christian apologetic stuff, which is worth reading. It's like reading things about ancient astronauts. It's instructive. That's one way to learn about fallacies. But he wrote a whole book on miracles, and here's some excerpts from that. Our senses are not infallible. If anything extraordinary seems to have happened, we can always say that we have been the victims of an illusion. If we hold a philosophy which excludes the supernatural, this is what we shall always say. What we learn from experience depends on the kind of philosophy we bring to experience. Well, that's certainly true, isn't it? You think that Zeus and Apollo are doing everything, then your experience will seem very different. And Lewis says, it's useless to appeal to experience before we have settled as well as we can the philosophical question. And he says also, for if miracles are impossible, then no amount of historical evidence will convince us. If they are possible, and this is talked about the bulletin, take that with you as I say, if miracles are possible but immensely improbable, then history can never convince us that a miracle occurred. If, on the other hand, miracles are not intrinsically improbable, then the existing evidence will be sufficient to convince us that quite a number of miracles have occurred. I use the word miracle to mean, and this is important as to how you define miracle, an interference with nature by supernatural power. Unless there exists, in addition to nature, something else which we may call the supernatural, there can be no miracles. So that's why I think this is going to become a big deal in the coming years as get away from some of the pseudoscience. And it says, we've said here in the Church of Free Thought from the beginning, really, the problem is the supernatural. It's not about gods. The gods business, I mean, the idea of an ideal being, a superhuman being, I mean, you can pick up comic books and read about that, people speculating as to what such a being would be like. But out of this error in the supernatural, that category mistake, and we've talked about that before too, how it's really a category mistake, mistaking one thing for another, all that stuff creates a lot of ridiculousness and harmful things. So that's where all that comes from. So Lewis goes on to distinguish naturalism and supernaturalism, and I think he gets that seriously wrong. We could do another whole service on that, maybe we will. But he's right that the basic issue is whether one accepts or rejects the possibility in a practical sense. I mean, in thermodynamics, you can calculate the likelihood that that you're going to, Randall, you turn into your son Carter. It's not impossible, but you can actually calculate the probability. So not impossible, but so improbable. Like the decay of protons. How long is it going to take the universe to completely disappear because protons fall apart? At the same time, Lewis just doesn't seem to get that what we call natural law is just, as Hume put it, and again, see the bulletin, pages separated. As Hume put it, the firm and unalterable Because it's built up of all the human experience today, you can't alter all the experience that's happened. The observation of those regularities of objective reality, that stands in contradiction to any claimed miracle. To accept that miracles are possible, again, in a practical sense, in the sense that they could or might happen in anyone's lifetime or even during the entire existence of our species, you would have to throw out all the experience that we've ever had. It's really the same as relying on facts and reason, as everyone does and must do, up to a certain point, and then totally disregarding that reliance in favor of faith without any other reason, just that I think it's good. To believe in miracles is just a repudiation of the long and laborious process of fact-based, rational trial and error that has produced all of our understanding of objective reality. So what do you say to someone who says, I defy you to explain whatever the miracle, purported miracle is, some experience that they take to be an interference with nature by supernatural power? Well, there's several ways of thinking about this. As Lewis says, our senses are not infallible. In fact, they're very fallible. Given the choice of believing that a misperception or a miracle has happened, the misperception is clearly the better choice. If interference by a supernatural force is to be considered, then why not also consider that natural extraterrestrial or extra-dimensional forces may be involved? Some alien federation of planets is studying us and introducing little things into our experience just to see how we behave. Let's see what happens if we do this to those primitive people. Could be a mischievous poltergeist. See movies about that, so you know that's real. Or mystical or psychic vortices, right? There in Sedona, Arizona, there's a mystical vortex or something, and there's one in Stonehenge too, Stonehenge or Stonehenge, however you say it. Or why not consider the possibility that the person having the experience has latent supernatural powers? I mean, after all, at least we know they have a mind, because they have a working brain. Well, somewhat word, maybe a not so good working brain, but at least they have a brain, where these ghosts and deities are supposed to be disembodied minds with no physical substrate. Isn't it more reasonable that the person has these powers than that God has them? Of course, the last two, those are still woo-woo, but at least they're a simpler woo-woo than the theological woo-woo. Trickery is a simpler explanation, and as it turns out, often a correct one, but it's so impolite. And deceit could be self-deceit. Still, it's not the burden of anyone else to come up with a sensible, non-supernatural explanation that's going to satisfy someone who has had an experience that they're inclined to consider supernatural. And it's very impolite of that person who's saying, I defy you to explain, it's very impolite of them to put that burden onto others. The alternative to not having a satisfying explanation of something is not an irrational explanation that repudiates well-established understanding, as I said, everything that we understand of how objective reality works. In any case, it's on the person claiming the miracle to prove that it's the doings of a gods or ghosts or whatever. It's not on other people to prove them wrong. Sorry, that's just the sad fact of the matter. We still sympathize with people's grief and all of that. Ultimately, this all comes down to the personal size problem of not knowing things, right? Go through our life, we don't know everything. A lot of times we feel we don't know anything. And not knowing things, that's just a part of the human condition. It's part of what everyone has to deal with, whether they recognize it or not. Is it a good thing to just make stuff up? And, you know, there's colorful expressions of what orifice that comes out of and so forth. And we all know those colorful metaphors. Or is it better to just not know? And to know, as Socrates admitted, that one does not know. As a Nobel Prize winning physicist and freethinker, Richard Feynman, put it, and I've got several quotes of his, he says, but I don't have to know an answer. I don't feel frightened by not knowing things, by being lost in a mysterious universe without any purpose, which is the way it really is, as far as I can tell, possibly. It doesn't frighten me. And also, I think it's much more interesting to live not knowing than to have answers which might be wrong. And finally, and he expresses many different ways. These are just three ways. He says, I would rather have questions that can't be answered than answers that can't be questioned. So I had a lot more material. Actually, I've got a couple more videos if there's time if you're interested. As you go through the miracle literature and start reading about this, there's also a quote out there from Einstein saying either Either you go through life with an attitude that nothing is a miracle or that everything is a miracle, right? Even the most ordinary, prosaic things are miracles. Because what? Because they impress you, because you don't understand them. Or, as Christopher Hitchens said, miracles, it's a suspension of the laws of nature. And keep in mind, this is what he adds to that. In your favor, that you like. When you get into a wreck, you don't call it a miracle. You only call it a miracle if it's a terrible wreck and you survived where you might have been expected to be killed. So either everything's a miracle or nothing is a miracle. So, and this element of the mysterious, the awesome, the impressive, and of course we all have that. If you don't have that, you haven't really, have not really accepted and experienced part of your humanity. So please think about it. And we have time for question and answer. Anybody you want to see, there's a nice video where Harris, what is the person named? Sam, where Sam Harris talks about miracles and the necessity of believing in miracles to accept some of the common religions that are out there.
We consider Christianity. The entire doctrine is predicated on the idea that the gospel account of the miracles of Jesus is true. This is why people believe Jesus was the Son of God, divine, etc. This textual claim, is problematic because everyone acknowledges that the gospels followed Jesus' ministry by decades, and there's no extra biblical account of his miracles. But the truth is quite a bit worse than that. The truth is, even if we had multiple contemporaneous eyewitness accounts of the miracles of Jesus, this still would not provide sufficient basis to believe that these events actually occurred. Well, why not? Well, the problem is that firsthand reports of miracles are quite common, even in the 21st century. I have met literally hundreds at this point of Western educated men and women who think that their favorite Hindu or Buddhist guru has magic powers. All the powers ascribed to these gurus are every bit as outlandish as those ascribed to Jesus. I actually remain open to evidence of such powers, but the fact is that people who tell these stories desperately want to believe them. All, to my knowledge, lack the kind of corroborating evidence we should require before believing that nature's laws have been abrogated in this way. And people who believe these stories show an uncanny reluctance to look for non-miraculous causes. But it remains a fact that yogis and mystics are said to be walking on water and raising the dead and flying without the aid of technology, materializing objects, reading minds, foretelling the future, right now. In fact, all of these powers have been ascribed to Satya Sai Baba, the South Indian guru, by an uncountable number of eyewitnesses. And he even claims to have been born of a virgin, which is not all that uncommon a claim in the history of religion, or in history generally. Genghis Khan supposedly was born of a virgin, as was Alexander. Apparently, parthenogenesis doesn't guarantee that you're going to turn the other cheek. But Satya Sai Baba is not a fringe figure. He's not the David Koresh of Hinduism. His followers threw a birthday party for him recently, and 1 million people showed up. So there are vast numbers of people who believe he is a living God. You can even watch his miracles on YouTube. Prepare to be underwhelmed. it's true that he has an afro of sufficient diameter as to suggest a total detachment from the opinions of his fellow human beings. But I'm not sure this is reason enough to worship him. In any case, so consider, as though for the first time, the foundational claim of Christianity. The claim is this, that miracle stories of a sort that today surround a person like Satya Sai Baba become especially compelling when you set them in the pre-scientific religious context of the first century Roman Empire, decades after their supposed occurrence. We have Satya Sai Baba's miracle story attested to by thousands upon thousands of living eyewitnesses, And they'll even merit an hour on the Discovery Channel. But you place a few miracle stories in some ancient books, and half the people on this earth think it a legitimate project to organize their lives around them. Does anyone else see a problem with that?
Any of you see a problem with that?
No.
And I checked this out, this Satya Sai Baba. He's died a few years ago, but it's true. This guy would like materialize a little, and he does this. He's got this long robe, saffron robe, and he kind of shakes his sleeves a little bit, and then suddenly he's got a little item in his hand, right? I mean, we've all seen Penn and Teller do more amazing things than that, right?
Were they putting flowers?
Little necklaces and things that certainly looked like they were of human manufacture, not of divine origin. How many of you ever seen a performance of David Copperfield? I mean, this is a guy that made a 747 disappear. Yeah. He vanished the Statue of Liberty. He went and flew around the Grand Canyon without a green screen. No, he doesn't say how he does these things, so I guess he must be God.
But I think the public even acknowledges that it's a trick, like the Statue of Liberty disappearing.
Yeah, he had the audience on a platform, and then when he put a big sheet up,
yeah.
The audience did not realize they were on a platform that rotated.
Oh, you saw how he did the trick.
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, they used to have a show with some guy that debunked all these different tricks, that exposed all these tricks by magicians.
All right, so here's this quick video that Kip got off the internet that was supposed to be part of the Wokeness of Science.
It's known to happen all over the world. A religious statue appears to cry. Devout Catholics flock to it, believing it to be a miracle. From weeping Mary statues in California to a tearful Jesus in Israel, usually it's just a matter of personal faith. But now, one man in Mumbai is facing jail time for debunking what was thought to be a similar miracle. In March, water began dripping down a statue of Jesus on the cross at Our Lady of Velankani in Mumbai. Parishioners collected the so-called holy water. Others drank it, hoping it would cure ailments. But rationalist and atheist Sanal Edamaruku investigated and said it was actually sewage water percolating through the statue because of a leaky water pipe.
The priest stopped the prayer for a while for this water to be distributed. And he had been giving this water, the assistant priest had been distributing this water and brought to me also. People were giving him a spoon from their palm and he was just licking it without knowing what it was.
Now he's being charged with blasphemy under section 295A of the Indian Penal Code, which accuses him of, quote, deliberately hurting religious feelings and attempting malicious acts intended to outrage the religious sentiments. Edamaruku argues his actions fall under free speech.
It's against the fundamental right that I have. It's against my own duty. I mean, this is a question of human rights.
But the Catholic Christian Secular Forum, which filed the complaint to police, says the law is the law.
Sanal should realize that his right to expression must not encroach on my right to freedom of faith, of belief, of religion, which is guaranteed under the Indian Constitution.
After being denied anticipatory bail in June, Edamaruku flew to Finland, where he remains in exile. The Christian Secular Forum says they're willing to withdraw the complaint against Edamaruku if he apologizes. Edamaruku says he will not.
They should be thankful to me, at least helping to stop this dirty water being distributed to people further.
Edamaruku has even appealed to India's Prime Minister to change the century-old blasphemy law with no success. He wants to see the law abolished because he says it contradicts the country's constitution. Some believe Edamaruku's actions aren't criminal at all.
295A requires a deliberate and malicious act. What has this man done? He's a rationalist. He's giving you a rational, non-spiritual, non-hypothetical explanation.
This case may come down to India's contradictory laws of blasphemy and free speech, but it also may be a question simply of fact versus faith. Either way, speaking the truth has come at a high price for Sanal Edamaruku.
Ram Ram Gopal, CNN, Atlanta.
See, you coddled Americans, you don't realize the freedoms you enjoy.
Well, one note about lotteries is that, you know, even the person who wins might have one chance in a couple of hundred million of winning, believes it's a miracle, but there's a 100% chance that somebody will win. And that's
right.
They don't take that into account.
And that's and isn't that the fallacy of the lottery? I mean, there's so many different fallacies that they've all got. Some of them have more than one name. But I was in Italy in March, and just out of curiosity, looked up. Now, in France, they have a wonderful tradition. You can say any bad thing you want about religion and ideas that you consider stupid, free speech. In Italy, they actually have these anti-blasphemy laws. Do they have anything like that in Persia? In Iran?
Like
laws against insulting Muhammad and stuff like that?
Oh, yes.
So these things are not gone from the world. And, of course, the United Nations, if you read about some of their doings, people that come from these parts of the world that have these traditions that you may not speak ill of my prophet, they like to get conventions and things like that going in the United Nations and in the international agreements and so forth to crack down on people who disturb someone else's freedom of faith. I also have a Christopher Hitchens clip. He also says some similar things about miracles, but the Satya Sai Baba thing Sam Harris mentioned, just devastating. And you can look this up for yourself. Satya Sai Baba, his name is. He claimed to be a reincarnation of Sai Baba, who was another guy. And it's just, we live in our own little bubbles, and it's important that you know what's outside of them. Anybody else with comments about any of these subjects or about anything else?
If Sai Baba died just a few years ago, how can someone today get reincarnation?
Well, no, this Satya Sai Baba, he claimed to be a reincarnation of an earlier Sai Baba who died in the 1920s or something like that. The story with the Satya Sai Baba who died recently, and of course he's claimed he's going to come back, so we'll see what kind of fraud will take up his mantle. What's that?
Houdini.
Yeah, Houdini. And you know, and that's another thing that factored into this that I thought of including in the presentation is, you know, if it was really true that somebody could come back from the dead and interact, there was a famous case where he made deals with people and said, I'm coming back, you know, if there's an afterlife, I will let you know. And so far it hasn't happened. Yes?
So what's the motivation for the supposed gods to cause their statues on Earth to leave? Does anybody ever talk about the motivation, the why they think that happens?
To attribute to their existence. Well, they're going to glom into everything they possibly can. Did you research this? Did you?
Well, like the Our Lady of Akita one, it was basically to get this nun to, according to the nun, you know, she was supposed to get messages from this guardian angel, basically to align her with, you know, the forces of good type thing. So her claim was basically that they were warning her about how even part of the church was going to be corrupted and become evil.
I think you started your question with, what's the reason? I think you could probably end your question starting with the first phrase. Do they need a reason? They'll supply one.
Yeah, it's a recurring question that we all ask ourselves. I think that's one of the interesting things about this whole subject of religion is how people can persuade themselves, you know, how self-deception works, the how and why of that. It's fascinating, isn't it?
Yeah, I wanted to mention, this reminds me a lot of, there's a podcast I listen to, You're Not So Smart, and they've had a lot of good podcasts recently that I listen to, just commuting, backfire effect, motivated reasoning, all this stuff about how we convince ourselves of whatever is around us or what our things that reassure what we are.
Very true. We're not so smart. I think Socrates really had that hundreds of years before Christ is ever supposed to have lived. You know, all I know is that I know nothing. If you realize your own fallibility, the need to, but you can get better still. I mean, there's habits of thinking can be improved. Look how far we've come as a species.
I can't. There's been a couple of movies that have come out recently. Of course, the first one that I can think of was There Is a Heaven, and where the little boy has some months later, he admitted that he made it all up. But people that were telling me about this, they still are convinced. They haven't heard that that wasn't true. And then there was a movie about the little girl that was had a really bad illness that fell out of a tree and became cured. And so this the same person, you know, is saying, now, how in the world, that was a miracle that God performed, et cetera, et cetera. Being a doctor, what did you think about that movie?
Well, there's actually a supposed miracle where this lady got was in an accident, became paralyzed, and then she was cured at a religious meeting and so forth, and there's YouTube on this as well. But she won't release her medical records, so you can't figure it out. Mm-hmm. Now, years ago, Robert Tilton, remember, he was the guy who put his hand up on the television screen, put your hand on mine and you'll be cured. And he got sued because he was sending out letters to some of his donors saying, yes, Jesus talked to me this morning and says he's got a cure for you and you just need to send him another $100 or something like that. But these letters are going to people who'd already died. So he was sued for intentional infliction of emotional distress, I believe, was the tort they were using. And they said, okay, fine, we'll prove that he did all these cures, and they provided a lot of medical records. And I, through the grapevine or something, I was asked by some of the attorneys involved to review these medical records, so I got to look at them. And they were just crazy stuff, you know, things like a guy having a lesion in his cheek and it was removed and it showed cancer. So the doctor said, well, we want to go back and remove more to make sure we got it all, or we want to go and get some lymph nodes or something. The guy said, no, Jesus will cure me. Well, okay, so he lucked out, you know, he got the treatment, the removal of the tumor. And that's happened in my own patients where I've removed something and came back cancer, sent her to the cancer specialist. They do a wider excision and everything comes back negative. So then I can look at me, I've cured the patient to begin with. But why do you do these things? Because what's at stake is the person's life. So you go back and do a wider excision. And then there was another case where somebody was trying to get pregnant and they were having difficulty, and then they did the old TV screen thing and then they got pregnant. Wow. Well, that happens all the time too. I see patients all the time who are trying to get pregnant, and I tell them, while we're fussing around gathering information, you still could get pregnant. And some, sure enough, sometimes it happens. So none of these things defy or appear to be suspensions of the laws of nature. No good documented case of that. I tried very hard to look up. You know, the Catholic Church will not make anybody a saint unless three miracles, and one of the recent popes changed it to two, have been documented and proven. And supposedly this is very rigorous. They appoint a devil's advocate, like they got in touch with Christopher Hitchens to have him be a devil's advocate because they knew he was a critic of Mother Teresa. And I found online where Christopher Hitchens basically said, yeah, they contacted me, they interviewed me, but I wouldn't want them to be a kind of devil's advocate. They went and talked to me, that's all, so that they could say, yo, we checked it out rigorously, and yes, the beams of light did come out of the picture of Mother Teresa and healed this lady who would have gotten better anyway. But the interesting thing is that, whereas if you go to the Nobel Prize website, you can find all their awardees, and they have their addresses and links to the research. You know, it's well documented, you know, what these people got the Nobel Prize for. If you go to the Catholic and the Vatican website, I couldn't find anything that would be like a list of saints. You know, where's the list of people that they've certified are in heaven because they went through this rigorous process and definitely these documented, proven miracles? I couldn't find any. If any of you go want to go out there and find it, if you can find it, I'll be happy to say I was wrong. But you think that would be front and center, you know, part of the Catholic PR machine. But it's almost like they'd rather have it be just kind of somebody says that somebody said that somebody said that this is the way it is, so everybody accepts that. But there's no actual documentation, so they get all the advantages of it actually as if they did do this. Went through this rigorous process without actually having to do it.
Well, you have all these claims of medical improbabilities being reversed and everything, but you don't see one single thing that very clearly cannot be reversed. It's amputation. You don't see any amputees being healed.
Yeah, why doesn't God heal amputees? I was at the Vatican in March. I was in Italy with my daughter. We walked through the Vatican and I was a little afraid because Italy has these anti-blasphemy laws. It's like, if you heal my foot, I won't believe, okay? I will go and become a Catholic priest if you heal my foot. Because have never been cases of degenerated, absent, damaged bones just suddenly appearing normal. That'd be nice.
Amen.
Like you said, you go to these chapels, they got some crutches up there. Where's the prosthetic limbs? Not there.
I saw one video where it was a profile view of a guy. You could clearly see his arm movement. It started off with him short, and then he moved his arm while they were praying for him. It was hilarious. It's on YouTube somewhere, but it's
why are people motivated to do this? Because they believe, and they want you to believe. And they want their belief to be reinforced by your belief. If they can get you to believe, then that will make them feel better.
Sure. Well, and they want to be the one who is righteous enough to receive the miracle.
Right. And there was a study, actually, you can look this up online, where some flying saucer cult said that flying saucers are going to come and take care of us on a certain date and time. And they went and prayed and whatever they did. You know, they were waiting for this big event. And then it didn't happen. After it didn't happen, they got even more motivated to go out and convert other people to their way of seeing things as a way of presumably compensating for the fact that they were disappointed. So,
Raelians, is that the main one?
The Raelians are one of these groups, but I don't think that's the one. It was somewhere in the Midwest years ago where the sociologists got a hold of this. Yeah. Yes, Bonnie?
There's actually a really excellent video on YouTube where this British mentalist named Darren Brown.
Oh, yes.
He has a special about faith healing that anybody wants to watch. It's really good.
I think that's his video that we've linked to also on our Twitter and Facebook feed, where he goes through this process with an atheist. She's actually a scientist, a stem cell researcher. And he induces a religious experience in this woman.
Yeah.
It's quite interesting. I think if you go to our Facebook page, it's on there. Mm-hmm. Darren Brown, I think that's the guy.
He's excellent. He does all kinds of videos debunking psychics and things like that. His main thing is that he's just an incredible mentalist. He'll say up front, all of my stuff is just trickery, it's not magic, but he goes through and he does a bunch of different videos like that too, so they're really good.
Now, wasn't there a TV show where a guy helps them solve crimes who's like that too? He's like a reformed psychic? I want to say it's called The Mentalist.
Yeah.
You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Good show.
Did we hear of a guy called Dean Harkness?
Oh, yeah, he was a famous fraud. Yeah. Randy exposed him.
I don't know if you know anything about homeopathy, but you can still find some homeopathic remedies at local stores and whatnot, but they're all treatments for things that are guaranteed to go away in a few days or a few weeks.
Yeah, right.
Well, what's crazy is that these things are being promoted. They're being promoted, funny enough, as an alternative medicine.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if it works, it's medicine. I mean,
it's like alternative facts.
Yeah. You don't. It's not alternative if it works. It's just medicine.
Right. What's the alternative medicine? Not medicine.
I'm bringing up homeopathy because that's a good example of what Hume talks about: miracles being refuting all of scientific knowledge. I mean, homeopathy, that is composed of, made of several things, but one of them is that if the more you dilute something, the more powerful it becomes.
Right.
I mean, if that were true, it would invalidate every dose-response relationship ever constructed for every effective medication that we know of.
Mm-hmm.
But what are you going to believe? This claim with poor evidence that they're spending all this money on to try to prove, or this huge body of evidence, and as I say, every dose-response, I mean, you can prove it yourself. Put a little dye into some water and put more in, and it gets darker. And if you dilute it, it doesn't get darker. It gets lighter and lighter.
Right.
So,
there was a homeopathic healing gel that turned out to have belladonna in it. It didn't have any of the things being regulated.
That's very true, too. A lot of the quack, and in fact, the Attorney General of Texas over the years, a lot of really bad and fraudulent stuff is advertised on the Spanish language channels because they don't police, it's thought that they don't police that as much.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's really terrible. Did we say anything here today that any of you disagreed with, that you thought was unfair, that was religion bashing?
I'm all for it.
Just curious.
I just have somewhat about like a small group, an Asian group, about this like 6 to 9 years around this time, down in Houston, there's somebody he used the psychology, the guilt, the myth, and then the fortune teller combined it, and his name is the Nice Great Uncle.
Wow.
His business is from mouth to mouth. He used that, he said that he has a superpower of the spirit of infant, baby, like abortion, you know. Those kind of spirit was behind him. So he can just do the, like a TV, the fortune telling, like if you want to ask your future and your meet your ancestor or your deceased relatives, that such kind of thing. He can did it incredibly. He very good at it, psychologically manipulate people. And people was believing him, paying a lot of money to him. He doesn't accept money. So he it's hard to sue him. He doesn't accept money. He accepts donation. So people I heard from people like believing him said he can tell everything if you have some question, you know, doubt or don't know what to do next. You went to him. He just helped you. And then he can tell very exactly and precisely and guide you. It was with the divine that kind of power to, he can know the future. So people were here, were go down to Houston. They said that you have to line up in the early morning at 4 o'clock in front of his the business he did. It was like not a really a business, just like a residential area, some place.
Wow.
You have to ask some people like who knew him.
Wow.
Yeah. I don't know whether he's still running the business. It was I heard a lot of people were telling me that.
There's
like people
gangsters.
That lost money,
yeah.
they divorced, they lost their loved one by accident, all were like try this, you know. Going down to Houston and did that for asking him something about it.
There's just scammers everywhere.
Yeah.
In fact, you're making me think of a patient that moved from Houston years ago and came to see me, and she couldn't understand why she wasn't getting pregnant, and we got her records. She'd had her tubes tied. And she said, yes, but my boyfriend says he knows how to have sex with me in a way that makes the tubes come untied.
You gotta keep trying.
What a scam, you know? Let's have sex again. I know if I do it one more time, I can make it come untied.
I was going to say, Jerry Burton has another good special about people that can talk to the dead.
Yeah.
But I think that the brain, people's brain, probably because of human nature, some weakness, it's very hard to prevent those kind of things.
Yeah.
If you talk to people, we can see the mind work.
Mm-hmm.
Like for us, when we talk about this, we feel like it's right. You need to get the fact, you need to reason, you need to...
Yeah, but none of us are bulletproof
but
either.
All those people, they just want to believe, you know.
Yeah. Well, talking to the dead is easy. It's getting responses that's hard.
Some people do get that scary.
Your voice is. Well, we can continue a discussion at Jason's. How many are going to Jason's? Y'all, anybody need help in getting there? We go to this Jason's over at MacArthur. Oh, and very important, especially for our newcomers, is that on the back of the programs, which try to stick to some degree, but on the back is an evaluation. Please let us know how we did. Please let us know your email address so we can put you on the